Hi again, everybody. Dave Bernhardt along with Rick Venturi as we get set for Class 4A football. And in this one, Rock Island Alleman, Rochester. You talk about contrasting styles. We've got it here in this one.
This is contrasting in every way. And I think it'll live up to the billing as well. As opposed to our last game where everybody expected this, I don't think anybody expected this. And when we come back in a minute, we want to talk about the real contrasting styles in the two teams, because it leads to a very interesting matchup.
This will be a fun one in Class 4A. We've already crowned three state champions. Number four will either be Rock Island Alleman or Rochester. Come on back. We'll get things started. 4A championship coming up next. The 2010 football championships brought to you by Country Financial. The following is a presentation of the IHSA Television Network. Tonight, it's 4A football. The Rock Island Alleman Pioneers and the Rockets from Rochester hook it up. The 4A title at stake. What a way to wrap up day number one of your IHSA football finals. A pair of 13-0 teams, the top-ranked Rochester Rockets, number two Rock Island Alleman Pioneers, and that's how we will go at it in 4A. Dave Bernhardt along with former NFL coach Rick Venturi. Rick, we talk about contrasting styles offensively. Break it down.
Well, first of all, in Rochester, you got a fast tempo. You got a spread offense that'll spray the ball all over. We haven't seen that today. We haven't seen that many passes. They do a great job with it. They're very efficient with it. No huddle. They're going to quick tempo it. And on the other side of the ball, on Alleman, you have a true flex bone offense, a true option offense. Again, like an Air Force, like a Navy, ball control, throw only when you have to. Run the inside veer, then the triple option to the outside. So it's just two contrasting styles. It's like watching Texas Tech play Navy, if you will.
Get yourself settled in. We've got 4A football, Rochester and Alleman, coming up next on the IHSA Television Network. Fans from Rock Island Alleman getting set. They'll meet the opponents from Rochester. To get a perspective down in the field, let's go to Aaron Bent and Sophia Manier.
Yeah, I just had a chance to speak with Rochester head coach Derek Leonard. He says the key for the Rockets tonight is keeping the ball in their possession and running their offense the way they want to dictate it. And as the snow starts to fall here on the field, he says he doesn't think the weather will be too much of a factor the way it hindered Tuscola and Moroa to a certain extent today. He says he thinks his quarterback has a strong enough arm. They've just got to be careful when they're going into the wind and capitalize when the wind is behind them. Let's toss things over to Sophia Minert with a look at the Alleman Pioneers.
Guys, David DeJager's Alleman defense has the task of slowing down this high-powered Rochester offense, which has amassed over 5,000 total yards and over 500 points this season. He says defensively the key for his guys is going to be to stop the run, make Rochester one-dimensional, and get pressure on West Lund, make it a difficult night for him throwing the ball. Offensively, you know they're going to run the ball, so he says they have to control the line of scrimmage and also take care of the football. I asked if he had any concerns with the wind. He shook his head and said, nope, we'll be just fine. Guys, back up to you.
That's split in, number 46.
All right, Sophia, we are ready to go. So are the fans here at Memorial Stadium. We've got the kickoff coming up next. Get a look at the Rochester Rockets. First time in a state championship game in football, 13-0, ranked number one in the state all year long. They're led by quarterback Wes Lunt. He's just a junior, but he is going to be one of the great ones in Illinois. He's had a great year, and he makes this offense go for Rochester.
He really does. He can make all the throws. He's very smart. He can run when he has to, but he really is the pivot of this offense. When you run a spread offense like they do, there's a lot on that quarterback's plate. He's done a really good job. I think the thing to look for tonight, one of the things that is hidden within that spread offense, is how valuable those quick screens are to the outside. Those guys almost consider them runs mentally, so Alleman's going to have to really get great pursuit to those plays.
Get a good look at Derek Leonard, first of all, from Rochester, 45-20 in his sixth year. There's Dave DeJager, 10 years, 77-30 record. He was last here in 2005. That's when his team finished second to Sacred Heart Griffin, coached by Ken Leonard, the father of Derek Leonard. So a family affair as far as Rochester Springfield Sacred Heart. For Rockford, Rock Island Alleman, they want to make that one extra step. Here's what it looks like tonight. You're here at RNC. The snow's starting to fall a little bit. 25-degree wind chill, and a wind can be a factor in the kicking game and possibly in the passing game tonight, 16 miles per hour.
What Alleman wants to do tonight is they want to run that ball. They want to make first downs, eat clock, take the air out of the football tonight. They want to reduce this game, take the fast pace away from Rochester.
They'll get a chance to do that first. Rochester to kick it off. John Perry. He's ready. So are we. 4A title game underway. A nice hop into the hands of Kevin McGinnis. And the Rochester defense swarms down McGinnis
on the kickoff.
Just a 13-yard return to the 25-yard line. Alleman got to this game by way of a 19-0 shutout over Sandwich in the semifinals. This is a quarterfinal thriller, a 21-20 win for Alleman over Richmond Burton. Thanks in part to Tim Boland's efforts, the quarterback for Alleman, a team that's throwing a little bit more this year than they have in the past.
Start out in unbalanced, Dave. Unbalanced to the left. Extra guy to the left.
That's the way they go.
Right off the option, right off the bat. Good tackle. Really fine tackle.
Pitch that time went to Justin Quintana. He will get very short yardage. The Rochester defense overlooked a little bit this year because of the prolific offense. Only giving up 10.6 points per game. Nice job to force the pitch. Number 81, Michael Gunter for Rochester. Up the middle to the fullback, Max Mendoza. Mendoza, not much running
not
room,
much but there.
Mendoza happy to be here. Here is that look at Rock Island Alleman. Their path here, we talked about that Richmond Burton game. They survived a touchdown by Richmond Burton with 3 seconds left in the game, and then Richmond Burton missed an extra point. That enabled the Alleman Pioneers to head into that game against Sandwich, which brings them here to Champaign. And a third and long, third down and 7. We mentioned Max Mendoza happy to be here. He had to sit out last week's game with a concussion. He was cleared to play and he's ready to go, and he got the second carry of the game. And now Boland to throw. Or not. Riley McMinn, he's headed to the University of Iowa, as coach Derek Leonard said he is going to be a great pass rusher in college. He already is at the high school level, and he dumps Boland for the loss.
Yeah, he's a really active defensive end. He's going to a great program where he'll develop, but he is really an impact guy on the edge. You're going to have a hard time throwing the ball to your right unless you have a real plan for him.
6'6", 230-pound defensive end.
Rochester's big inside, too. They showed it on that inside run. They were a solid wall in there.
Patrick Ewald, DuPont. High kick that's going to get caught up in the wind, though. Takes a pretty good hop for Alleman, but it will be Rochester with good field position. They'll start right near midfield, and it was a quick three and out. The 31-yard punt by Ewald gives the ball now to the Rockets.
And now we're going to see a little bit different structure right here, Dave, after that first game and that first series. Wes Lunt can play at quarterback.
And he's going to get his team up the line in a hurry. Don't blink. Look at those numbers.
No huddle. 3-by-1 spread. One single back.
Quite likely going over 3,000 yards passing here this season. I'll give it to Colton Glazebrook.
Glazebrook right off the bat. And they like to run what I call the midline play. A lot of teams run it with zone. They run it with a pull, pulling the guard and the tackle. Now they just shift Glazebrook the other side.
And that's right.
Still 3-by-1.
They sit at the line, they snap, and here we
go. Here's that first bubble screen of the night.
The completion to Gunter.
Gunter's a really good football player. plays both ways, so I make a good defensive play early. But again, those bubble screens, we call them bubble screens, those are like runs. Now, quick tempo, going right back out, 3-by-1 to the field to the right.
They get a quick 10 yards to Gunter, one of four receivers for Rochester with 30 or more catches this season. On the ground to Glazebrook, he's got a big hole.
Same play, both guard tackle pull, guard tackle pull with trap action. That's how they keep the pass rush away from you.
For Rochester, their big game came in the semifinals. Obviously big wins in terms of amount of victory, but against Metamora, that avenged a 41-40 loss in the semifinals last year in a game where Rochester scored late. They elected to go for two, did not get it. Instead, Metamora came here to Champaign.
Now they spread it, Dave. They spread it totally. No backs in the backfield.
Blunt quickly, that pass is batted down. That was knocked down.
Good job by Fleewinger. Good job out there knocking that ball down. This is tough. Defense got to get set in a hurry. They actually substituted under fire. That's hard to do. Now they get in a traditional set, getting the I formation change up.
They don't do this often.
Nope. There's a little power play on third and one. Jump to it really quick.
First down to the 26-yard line, and if the pace of this game feels quick to you, you're feeling it. This is what it is.
Now they're gonna stay with that I formation. They got the tight end in the backfield.
Glazebrook again.
Little counter, the old counter tray with both the guard tackle pulling. That's how they like to run. They like to pull people when they run, pull and trap.
He's shoved back by Ryan Sheely, 6'1 senior who goes both ways for the Pioneers. There's Colton Glazebrook. Came into this game with 36 touchdowns and over 1,500 yards rushing. He's a busy man early. He'll be inside the 20.
You know, it's tough sometimes, even as a defensive coordinator, in this tempo, there's a tendency you'll lose sight of the down and distance if you're not careful because it's on you so fast. And they're staying with this I formation, pretty interesting right here.
Now, Lunt
now they
stands.
Saw the defense, they saw it, so they can check it. They check it from the sideline for them. Okay, they didn't like what they saw there, so they're gonna take a timeout.
Derek Leonard doubles as the offensive coordinator. He brings his team in front of him. Opening drive of the game for the Rockets here in your 4A title game. Wes Lunt brings his team back onto the field, faced with a third down and two, and Derek Leonard elected to take a timeout there. You said they...
Yeah, he was in that I formation. I think Alleman loaded the box. I don't think he liked the play. So rather than blow it in a critical situation, take timeout. That's smart. Now they go back to the gun. They're 2-by-2 this time. They're balanced. Glazebrook right to his left. Now see, he's checking, see something. Alleman's in a nickel defense. Now five defensive backs in there.
Lunt to keep it. He doesn't run often, but he is effective in that one. He gets himself a first down.
And that's the read that's been made popular now by Oregon and all the college spread teams. If he sees the end close, he can pull that ball out of Glazebrook and run with it. Now jump the spread, first down.
Last year, Rochester had Sean Robinson. He's now at Purdue. He was a Tim Tebow type. He would run the ball 15 times per game. Lunt's a passer, but he's got to chase this one down. And he covers it up at the 30.
Big break. Big break. That tempo was killing Alleman. That's a big break for him. They get him now behind in a count.
Coming right at you. Not what Rochester wanted, a loss of 16. It was almost as if our camera people knew there was a bad snap coming. Lunt time on the quick slant. He gets it to Zachary Grant. We'll get some of that yardage back.
And then right back on you.
Obviously a well-conditioned offensive unit for Rochester to pull this off play after play. It's third down and long. Looking for it all. Great defensive effort that time by Justin Quintana.
Quintana, really good coverage because that ball was thrown in there. That's a skinny post. He threw it right in there well. It's just good defense.
Now fourth down. 19 to go for a first down at 16-yard loss hurting momentarily. We'll see whether the Rockets can overcome that. Three receivers left. That's where Luntz looking to the end zone. And it is out of bounds. Unable to stay in bounds was Travis Everly. Again, good defensive pressure by the secondary to make sure Everly had no place to get those feet in.
That's the only place you can throw that ball, Dave. You either throw it for the touchdown or you make sure they don't get it. That's really a nice throw right there.
Mm. Ooh, we got it missed it by half a foot.
Half a foot, half an inch. That's a fine throw up on that fade right there.
Kevin McGinnis on the coverage. That ball, that was a better throw on the replay than it even looked.
Oh, God, that was a nice fade.
But instead, on downs, the ball goes to
Now we come back to the flex bone. Now we change gears. We go from high-powered spread to flex bone.
Boland on the keep.
Boland's an engineer. He handles the ball. He runs the option efficiently.
Three-year starting quarterback for the Pioneers. First team selection, Western Big Six Conference.
What they try to do is figure out how you're playing on the edge on that option, and they'll change the outside blocking schemes to try to take advantage of what you're doing on defense. That'll change the whole game long.
Boland picks up 4 yards on first down. And now Dave DeJager does not like what he sees. So two quick early timeouts, and we'll get one as well early on here in your 4A title game, your football championships, brought to you by Country Financial. IHSA Championship Football is brought to you by Country Financial. What's your idea of financial security? Rochester fans in that orange and blue. Their team 13-0, but the same can be said for the Alleman fans. 1-2 in the state. Boland on the pitch to the right side.
And if you notice there again, I told you this will be a science all day long. They changed the perimeter. That time they split two guys out there with the double wing, and they got a little bit of edge on that perimeter. You'll be watching that all night on that triple option, how they try to get to the edge.
Kevin Weatherall with that last carry.
Weatherall's a really fine all-purpose player, both offensively and defensively.
An Illinois High School Football Coaches Association All-State selection.
I'm still amazed at how well Lunt threw that ball in that first series without getting a touchdown. I mean, he threw the post and threw the fade. I could take a couple fades like that with my Rams on Sunday.
Just a junior. First down and 10. Motion to the left side from Quintana. Boland wants to throw.
Oh, he's got him on the wheel. Oh, and he overthrew him.
It was right there. I was actually surprised that ball got out there as quickly as it did to Quintana. He had room.
They created a quick, by motioning Quintana into a 3-by-1, they created three receiver side and just ran a flatten up to Quintana.
Ooh, just over the outstretched arms.
Missed.
Travis Everly on the coverage. He was happy to see that ball fall incomplete. The offensive line of Alleman.
Big Brolin and Odell. You're looking at 276 and 300 in there, Dave. You're looking at NFL tackles.
Boland. Broken up out there. And that was John Gilson on the coverage. Again, they were looking for Quintana.
Definitely trying to get him isolated on linebackers and trying to get a big play out of the backfield to him. This one almost went the other way. This is a tough one when you throw all the way across that field like that.
Looks like that a first and 10 has become a third down and 10. Both sides of this stadium come alive here in the first quarter. Option pitch, McGinnis, cut down. It was Gilson again, this time on the tackle.
John Gilson, really good form tackle come up. You know, they tried to trick him. They had a third and long. He tried to run the speed option. Rochester wasn't fooled.
So number 79, Ryan Broglin chasing. He's a 276-pounder. You mentioned Aaron O'Dell. He goes 305 in that defensive front. And then you have Riley McMinn along with Taylor Hill on the ends. It's a tough, tough defensive line. They have forced this punt from Ewald. And this is shanked. Makes a decent enough roll, and Rochester will have good field position again, starting from their own 42, 4:19 to play in the first quarter, following just a 24-yard punt.
And they're on the ball. We won't get a deep breath on this one. We're going right to work here.
You know, it's interesting you say that, Rick, because we don't get a breath. Imagine what those players dressed in green jerseys, they don't get a chance to catch it.
I want to tell you, I've called defenses in games like this. Remember the old Baltimore, the old Buffalo Bills and the great K-Gun with Jim Kelly, and that's what this reminds me of. You almost have to script your defenses, actually.
And Derek Leonard calling the plays, the head coach for Rochester. Lunt. There's that slant again. And it's good for a first down. And once again, it goes to Zachary Grant. A gain of 13.
Really good release. Good sting on the ball.
And he's got that good size. He can look over it all. 6 feet 5 inches tall. Now onto the ground.
Back to the OG, what I call OG, the guard tackle trap.
Colton Glazebrook, first down pickup of 12.
See, when they trap those plays, they make it very difficult to rush the passer in a team that can throw it all over the yard.
Well, that's one thing Dave DeJager, the head coach for Alleman, said, I've got to get to Lunt. They're not going to get to him there. First down completion to Gunter. Actually just short of the first down. They may give him that good spot there. He may have it. This is what Wes Lunt is looking at. His brother, Will Lunt, is at Western Illinois University. Lunt, the second leading passer all time in IHSA history with 8,308 yards. There's been some great quarterbacks who have come through Rochester in recent years. Lunt under pressure. They set up the screen to the near side. Glazebrook makes a cut. Glazebrook, another one to score.
Well-conceived play. Got the lineman out, got people blocked, got it to their money guy out there in the flat. But right now, Lunt is the director. I mean, the ball, he's throwing every type of pass you want. He's poised. Now they come with the screen. Nice, tight little throw to Glazebrook. Get them all out there. Tough duty on defense tonight.
That's the 30th touchdown pass of the year from Wes Lunt. Glazebrook with his third touchdown reception. It's an early 6-0 lead for Rochester. John Perry for the extra point, coming right at you, and it's a 7-0 Rochester lead as they take it right down the field. It didn't take them very long to do it, just a little over a minute. That's how they do it in Rochester. Let's take a look at the Lunt to Glazebrook connection.
Well, right here, they set up away from the 3-by-1, little slip screen, get people out in front of him. He makes one guy miss. And this is what they do to you. They create space all over the field. So, you know, a simple little screen pass, you know, you've got a lot of space between defenders. And Glazebrook's going to make one guy miss.
Derek Leonard loves Colton Glazebrook. He says he's the best running back he's ever coached. In fact, the best player outside of a quarterback that he's had. Great vision, and you could see it there, the side-to-side vision that Glazebrook brings to the table.
Well, honestly, Alleman's going to really have to get their offense going. Dave, they're going to have to find a way to make first downs and take some air out of this ball right now, because they're going to be taxed on defense. I can see that right now. This is as fine a passing attack as you'll see, not only in high school, but in most college levels. This is a terrific attack led by a really, really sharp young guy.
Talk about offense for Alleman, just 6 yards of offense compared to 86 yards for Rochester, and Lunt will keep that right arm warm. He just came off the field. He doesn't slow down.
Oh my
after
goodness.
They score. Just a junior, he will be one of the most highly recruited players in Illinois next season. We're going to see some great quarterbacks tomorrow in our 5, 6, 7, and 8A championship ball games. Wes Lunt gets us started here tonight. Perry will run this out of the ground and out of bounds. And Alleman will have decent field position to start following this penalty.
That's more throws in the first 8 minutes than we watched in the last 4 hours. But I mean, it's well conceived, and he's throwing it well. I mean, they're an inch away from a fade, that touchdown fade on the first series.
You know, and this is one of those offenses that, from our perspective, high atop Memorial Stadium, it's so much more interesting to watch than you can even see on TV, that we can show it to you on TV.
Illegal procedure.
All parts of the field.
I thought they looked really good on the tape that I watched, but actually watching them in person tonight, they're crisper. Lunt has a great delivery. It just looks to me there isn't a throw he can't make. He's already shown us the post, the fade, obviously touch on the screen. That's some pretty big time stuff right there. Now, Alleman's got to find a way to move the ball. They've got to find a way to move the football. You know, they want to run the option tonight. They want to get it on the perimeter. They somehow got to get it to Quintana and get an arc blocker in front of him and let him try to break one.
None of the backs in his backfield really have the spectacular numbers that we have seen in some other games. And Mendoza leads with 833 yards. Justin Quintana with 570 yards, 19 touchdowns for Justin. That time, Tim Boland carries for four. Boland on the pitch, Quintana. Can he get to the edge? He's run out of bounds. Good team speed on the defensive side. Gunter along with Grant. A lot of players going both ways for the Rockets.
Gunter, I think, is a really good player. Really impressed with him on tape. This is a guy that has range. He can come up and tackle like he just did right there. Just good defense right there by Rochester. Now you got third and manageable, third and three here. Again, Rock Island's got to make first downs. They got to keep it away from them.
Boland shook the tackle initially of Chase Walker, and then help came.
Good pursuit to Walker. Even though he didn't make the tackle, he was out there. He slowed the option down.
Boland eyeing.
See, he slows it down. He slows everything down. He buys time for everybody to get out there.
Taylor Hill, along with Kyle Kremitsky, were there.
Kremitsky was there.
Now Ewald will have to punt again. Gunter deep to return this punt if Ewald gets it to him. That was nearly blocked. Not a good one again. However, a flag is out.
That's going to be a big break. Big break for Alleman.
Riley McMinn says, not me, not me.
Personal foul. Roughing the kick here, first down.
Get a good look at our referee and crew chief, Joseph Slayton. Howard Harris joins him. He's a linesman. Our umpire is William Fields. Alonzo Smiley, the line judge, and Calvin White, the back judge, your 4A championship crew.
One thing, if I'm a linebacker in Rochester, I like playing behind those two big tackles and McGinn on my outside. I'm going to be able to flow to that ball pretty good. I think those two big guys are going to hold that middle pretty good.
Talking about Aaron Odell and Ryan Broglin, 305 and 276. But it's a first down for Alleman. They trail 7-0. Now into Rochester territory with 204 left here in the first quarter.
Hard duty in there. That's doing tough time up in there, but you got to keep them honest with some inside football.
Mendoza gets a few. This is an Alleman team as we get a look at Mendoza pounding into that line. They're happy with 3 or 4 yards.
Yeah.
They're content.
And they're in four down territory now. I mean, and that's how they have to win a game. And in doing so, you know, almost the longer it takes, the better, you know, because you got to take the ball out of Lunt's hands. I mean, you're going to have a hard time stopping that guy.
Well, this is your defense right here.
Right here. That's exactly right. There's the option.
Quintana, one man to beat. Shakes free of Gland, and he will have a first down.
And that's the great thing about option football. If you love option football, Dave, is you'll make people play the ball, and you will create one-on-one situations. And if you make a guy miss, and a guy like Quintana, it's hard to tackle him one-on-one with that much space. I mean, it's hard. A good fundamental position is too much space to get him down. But the option will freeze the inside people and keep your pursuit away to the edge.
Pioneers have moved the ball to the 32-yard line. Alleman 13-0, winners of the Western Big Six Conference, and flags will come out. There's some jumping on that line. That is one thing that Dave DeJager, the head coach for the Pioneers, very proud of, winning that conference title there, the smallest school in the Western Big Six. Got a big win early in the year against
defense.
Rock Island. That pretty much propelled them, took advantage of some other games where they played very well, and they bring a 13-0 record here in this title game. And that's a 5-yard penalty against Rochester.
You know, they came off two mediocre years, and they put it together, and they're a pesky bunch, just like right now. The game's down to a minute and five. If they can go in and score, you know, and you know, they will have eaten some clock here. They have to reduce the game to win it, to reduce the time of the game to win it.
Mendoza, only about a yard is all. You know, you mentioned that Alleman, some mediocre years. They were 5-4 each of the last 2 years, did not even qualify
right
for the IHSA playoffs, and here they are playing for a championship.
For a championship. I mean,
a second down and four after this 1 yard pickup by Mendoza. Happy to be here. Concussion laid him out. He had some numbness in that quarterfinal game. They had to take him off on a stretcher. Sat out last week in the semis, survived that one. And here he is starting the championship game, and that may be another jump on the defensive side of the ball. Rochester pointing over to Alleman. And they're going to point Rochester's way, so a couple of encroachment footballs.
Defense. First down.
Now this is what Rochester doesn't want to have happen. They don't want to concede yardage and give easy yardage, because, you know, that just reduces, again, it reduces the game.
First down, Alleman from the 21-yard line.
Now you're close to that red zone. Now's that defense got to tighten it up. You not a lot of depth to the field. Now you got to tighten it.
Bowen sees enough to get about 3 yards.
Bowen is a guy that just at the end of the day, he gets it done. He doesn't do anything flashy, but he operates this triple option to perfection. Makes good decision. We call it the ride and decide offense. He'll fake.
Only one score in the first quarter. It was a 23-yard pass completion from Lunt to Glazebrook. And that man, Derek Leonard, sees his team on top, 7-0. With former NFL head coach Rick Venturi, I'm Dave Bernhardt. So happy you've joined us here for our 4A title game. It's the fourth of four games here today. We'll have four more tomorrow. There's your first quarter stats, 86-29 yardage advantage for Rochester. But here it is, Rock Island inside the 20-yard line.
One thing, Dave, that methodical drives do, even when they're not pretty, to a high-powered offense like Rochester, is it frustrates them on the sidelines. And particularly if they go in and they score and they hold the ball for 6 minutes, it makes the offense a little jumpy on the other side. I've noticed that in playing defense over the years. And, you know, that's the thing about it. And you know, they have two downs, third down, treat everything four down territory.
This drive is already gone for 4 minutes. Ball outside.
Unbalanced line to the right, extra guy.
Mendoza stretches, he has the first down, first and goal, Pioneers.
It's not pretty, but there's an efficiency to Alleman. That's why they've gotten here.
Max Mendoza, the active runner so far today for Alleman.
I like that unbalanced line as a changeup, because it changes the gaps for those defenders, and sometimes they'll miss one, like in that play.
on first and goal. Good cut by Quintana. He is met and slowed down.
Can you hear that in there? For Justin Quintana, the ball carrier.
And it will be second down and goal. The ball will be placed down at the 7. Boy, he ran right into the arms of Dan
Camp.
What?
I thought he had it to the outside. I think he felt like they were pursuing fast. You know, they Alleman shifted really fast and got him on the edge of what they wanted. They're back to unbalance now. Back to the heavy side to the right.
Weatherall.
Weatherall. Good, tough second man through. See what they're doing here, getting in that unbalanced line, and they're trying to make Rochester play light on the left. Rochester right now is not overshifting, so they're giving up a little daylight over there to the unbalanced side. Both the original play to Mendoza and now back to Weatherall, right back almost in the same spot. Two different plays taking advantage of the unbalanced line.
From the 3-yard line, it will be the 12th play of the drive for Alleman. Third down and goal. Weatherall, he's in.
Big drive for Alleman. That's exactly what they have to do if they're going to stay in the game. That is convert third downs, eat clock, keep the ball away from Lunt, score with them, 7-7, new ball game, second quarter. They got to feel great about that one, Dave.
Boy, that was a 12-play march for Alleman. They were aided by a couple of penalties. And now Patrick Ewald will look to punch this one through.
But that's the script as an underdog. If you're going to do it with the flex bone triple option offense, that is to move the ball, but move it methodically and take time off the clock while you're moving it. Now here comes the fast break again as soon as we get the ball.
Kevin Weatherall from the left wing. Weatherall on the season. His 6th rushing touchdown. He just casually hands that ball, and it was a 65-yard drive. 25 of those 65 yards coming on Rochester penalties. But Alleman did exactly what they had to do. They got their yardage in their 3- and 4-yard chunks, and they took a chunk of time off the clock, nearly 6 minutes.
That's exactly right. That's just how you write it up if you're the underdog, if you're running that flex bone against a high-powered offense. Also, they made a living to the right. Everything they did successfully was to the right. But again, I like their unbalanced line. Their unbalanced line is going to create a few, they're going to have to adjust a little bit on the Rochester side.
5 minutes and 55 seconds.
We talked about that going in, Dave. That's what you're looking at today. Now they've got to put together a series. They've really struggled on defense, and you can understand why. They're all over the field. They're trying to play nickel, which is the right thing, but this guy can throw it. He can throw it through a very tight window.
There's your 5-minute, 55-yard drive, 65 yards. Kevin Weatherall, a touchdown run. Now we will see how jumpy that offense may have been for Rock Island. And I think they're tracking down the ball. There it is. the extra point by Ewald went over the net, and that's the ball they need to kick off. So that's a ball boy's job right there. Everybody's got 22 players standing on the field. The only thing you're missing was a football.
Well, that's one way to slow down Rochester. I mean, if I'm the Alleman coaches, I might get rid of that ball every once in a while. You know, trying to hide it on them there.
They still
haven't got it. They're fighting for it.
Which
over
one
there.
Do we want? Yo, you take it. I don't know. What do you want? What do you want? It's not mine. 9:45 to play here in the first half. 7-7 for a championship game.
I tell you what's been really impressive, and we saw it in the previous game, and we've seen it in this first quarter. The first quarter in 3 minutes, it is all the big time players are living up to the billing. I mean, it's terrific. You know, because sometimes that doesn't happen. You know, and it's just really great to see as not just an analyst but as a fan.
Somewhat short to the 20-yard line, and the return to the 32. 12 yards on the return. That was Gilson with it.
Now, it's like the Los Angeles Lakers coming out there. Now we're going fast. As fast as we can go.
Well, on one side of it, though, the Alleman defense, many players, though, going both ways for the Pioneers, yeah. But they you catch a little bit of a breather there. Rochester to start from the 31. They'll get the whistle of the ball in play, and now they will play.
Alleman trying to walk around the secondary, trying to get him a tough look. Your safeties are moving in and out in that nickel defense. They fake play action down the seam.
The collision now incomplete, they'll say. Big hit on the play.
Yeah, big hit. I'll tell you, that's another rope throw in there, though. I mean, he just threw into traffic, which he had to, because that's the play action to freeze him and throw it right down inside there.
Woo.
Whoa.
On the hit, Alan Hoogerwerth. Oh, my goodness.
I used to call that the no-fly zone in there. Oh, Hoogerwerth, he just established that no-fly zone right down that middle. Don't throw it in here, man. You better throw it outside. Don't throw it in here. Believe me now, they'll remember that, too. Those wideouts remember it.
Third down and four after a gain of six.
Is that nickel now?
Glazebrook. He has the first down, looking to stretch it. Colton Glazebrook into Alleman territory at the Pioneers 42.
If you notice there, he checked that run. He checked from trap to one side to trap the other side. As soon as Alleman moved their defense, as soon as they kicked their front, he checked the defense. Lunt checked the trap to the correct side. Now they're back into a five-man look.
21-yard run by Glazebrook. Quickly this side, it comes to Grant.
Grant, one of the many good receivers on this team. Grant, the outstanding guy.
Yeah, Grant, Michael Guntner, Blake Gland, Colton Glazebrook, all with 30 or more receptions.
And Everly had a big game. Yeah, they can spray it all over. As well as run it to Glazebrook. This is a fine offense. And they'll tighten the formation. So now see they keep the tight end in the box. So they get a little bit different run perspective. I like they subtly move around. They'll use that tight end in the backfield like a fullback. Sometimes he'll be on the edge and then sometimes he'll just spread you out. So they're constantly changing on you, constantly. Now they're keeping the tight end in the box here. So they get a power, they can run a power play to this side. And you see Alleman's having a tough time adjusting. Look at they're moving around. Look like an amoeba out there, you know.
And they were forced to use a timeout because they couldn't get one of their people off the field.
Couldn't get it off the field.
So with that will be the second timeout for Alleman, and we will take a break as well. We're tied at 7 with 8:35 to play here in the first half. Fans, you have to love them. It's all part of the festivities and the atmosphere here at your state football finals. There'll be some halftime performances coming up here in about 8 minutes and 35 seconds off this game clock. But right now, Rochester on the move in Alleman territory. First down snap coming up. That's one off 6 feet 5 inches. I'm standing tall back there in a little bit of confusion. I'm not sure exactly how that was supposed to play out, but a break for Rochester able to recover. Glazebrook comes up with it.
What will happen sometimes, Dave, is that you'll see that they'll check the play and they'll get a little bit off balance at times. Now they send a whole new group of personnel in.
Glazebrook had that right arm up like he was anticipating that snap coming to him. It certainly didn't play out that
total
way.
Spread. He's calling the patterns right there.
And that one is knocked down at the line. Great job by number 84, Patrick Ewald. He's already kicked an extra point today. He bats down that pass, and Ewald, get this, he played the lead role of Curly in the school musical Oklahoma. What a fall for Patrick Ewald. And it's third down and 14. Going for the home run.
Oh,
and they've got it.
goodness gracious.
What a throw to Travis Everly.
That is a major league seam right there. This quarterback is terrific. Really is. I liked him on tape, but what you have to watch him in person to appreciate the talent. And you know what I like about him? He does it effortlessly. You know, the great ones don't even have to sweat when they do it.
Everly will hope that one does not cost him. You can't drop it in there any better than that. And it's fourth down and 14. Overthrown, and Alleman defense is held.
Months pass for Zachary.
That muff on first down really hurt him. And again, Alleman just hanging in there. You know, he's just hanging in there. You get a break on defense. You don't. You drop a ball. You mess up a play on first down, and now go back there. And now what they got to do is engineer another 6-minute drive. That's what they got to do.
They'll start from their own 35-yard line.
Starting a double wing flex ball.
Pull back up the middle for three. What's new?
Even with those big tackles, they've got to keep them honest, because if you never run inside, even though it may be for 2 or 3 yards, those linebackers will be out on that option. So you gotta continue to run that fullback some and freeze those linebackers.
Keep those balls warm, that's right. That leather soft. Positive yardage across the 41.
Right on the edge of manageable right now. Right on the edge, that 3rd and 4, and this offense is manageable. But they're big, big third downs. Every first down you make in this situation, you'll take 3 minutes off the clock, Dave. And again, I keep calling clock because against this Rochester offense, you want to reduce the time of the game. Unbalanced.
Need to get to the 45-yard line. Bolin to Weatherall. Brought down by Gland. Yeah, Blake Gland was just sitting there waiting for him.
Glantz had a tough duty out there because that option, he's forced into a lot of one-on-ones, and he's made 2 fine tackles out there.
Well, he drops the Weatherall for the loss, so that makes no decision. You punt.
You got to punt.
It would have been very interesting.
Interesting. With a high-powered offense like this, if it's close, I'm going to try to keep him off the field.
Instead, Ewald will have to punt. Bobbled it momentarily. He's not had a good night. That one comes back sideways.
Well, this is a bit of a nightmare right now in the kicking game.
14 yards is all Ewald can manage on that one, and you give Rochester a fairly short field here with 5:42 to play in the first half. Rockets cheerleaders. Not a very long journey. Rochester just a little bit south and a little bit east of Springfield.
Now they cluster the formation for the first time. Those 3 receivers in rub positions, and they're going to run layers.
The completion goes to Grant.
Grant is an interesting guy. To me, he's one of the most versatile kids in the high school game today. He can play the outside. In that situation, he became the inside receiver, came back out on the sail. When you need a play, that's who you want to go to.
17 yards from Lund to Grant, and that one's knocked down at the line. That may have been Nick Kavanaugh. Kavanaugh just coming back from an injury. He missed 3 weeks, been banged up during the year, missed 3 weeks of the playoffs, getting a little bit of time last week for Alleman. He's an All-Stater, All-Conference performer. Ball at 37-yard line, 2nd and 10. It's been an injury-depleted team in recent weeks, now at full strength here in the championship game. They've been able to survive the injuries through the playoffs. Luck gets it out to Gunter. shake pass the defender, Adam Hoogerwerth.
Gunter's another dependable 6'3", 200, big physical guy that can catch it.
And that's the fans that wanted a late hit. Rochester fans wanted it. Glazebrook will be very close to the first down. Let's see where they put this ball down. To get to the 27, that's where they place it. This may be too close to call from on the field. I'll have to bring the chains across. It's the fourth game of four games today. We'll do it all over again tomorrow, starting at 10 o'clock right here on the IHSA Television Network. 5, 6, 7, and 8, those are your classes tomorrow. We already have crowned state champions in 1A. There's Lena Winslow in 2A, Smiling Newman Central Catholic in a thriller. Too bad if you missed that one. It was Illini West 22-20 winners over Stillman Valley in our 3A game. The first two games had a running clock. We have had good ones here once nightfall came upon Champaign. Stretching out that chain.
First down.
Right there.
First down.
7-7 game. This Rochester team coming in averaging 43.3 points per game. However, Rock Island Alleman has only given up 8.3 a game. They've only allowed 27 points, now 35 points here, 34 points in the state playoffs.
They may be blitzing here. They've played pretty straight up. No, they're going to walk out. They're going to fake it. They're going to walk out.
Look, we'll keep it.
And that's the read play off of that give. See, he has the option as he puts that ball in Graysbrook's stomach. If that end closes and there's nobody there, he has the option to read it and keep it.
His second down and 4, the 21 yard.
That's the second time he's done that. Now they're in a, you know, second and short. I don't know what down and distance means to this team. Actually,
I was going to ask.
I have no idea what it means.
Ball just outside the 20. Glazebrook all the way here to the 10. There was no decision to be made right there. You give it to Colton Glazebrook.
And really, Colton is perfect. Now they're going to jump in the eye, Dave. All of a sudden, now the tight end is in the eye. They show great versatility on this stuff.
Not much doing as the gang green defense closes the door.
84, Patrick Ewald.
Actually, gang green may pray for that eye formation after all that fast break stuff.
Yep. Second down and goal.
They're checking it now. I think they see that one-on-one coverage out here.
Where they're looking. Lunt running out of room, but he finds
nice
a man. They'll say, oh, incomplete pass. Taylor Hill was the intended receiver. It will be third and goal from the 10.
Showed good athleticism getting out there to the right on the run. Still makes an excellent throw. I mean, they just don't come up with it. This kid is, again, making every throw.
With 3:13 to play here in the first half, looking to punch in a go-ahead score. The cut
good
by
play.
Glenn gets him a couple of yards, and it's fourth down. Solomon defense, no stars on it. All they do is they just go out and play solid D, and now they just have 8 yards protect here on fourth down, and Rochester will bring on their field goal team. John Perry will come in. Perry 2 for 2 on the season. As long has been a 28-yarder. I'll put this one down. It will be a 25-yard attempt.
Dave, that's a terrific stop there. That's a big red zone stop to hold them to 3 here, as high powered as they are with 2:34 to be, you know, within 3.
Perry out of the hold of Glenn. His kick is up And it is through, and Rochester has taken a 10-7 lead. We have 2:23 to play in the first half. Alleman will get their hands on the ball when we come back. It's the 2010 IHSA Football Championships, brought to you by Country Financial. John Perry just booted that ball through the uprights for a three-point Rochester lead, and now he'll kick it off to Alleman. 2:23 to play here in the first half. Well, it was 3 points for Rochester, but you almost get the feeling it was a victory for Alleman on that last drive.
You really do. You know, I used to sell my guys that when you make them settle for a field goal, half the time it's demoralizing. Now, they think the key issue here is that Lunt is as good as advertised. He's really good. And Alleman's hanging in there. They're tough. They're tenacious. They're fighting to stay in there. But again, they've got to make first downs. They can't give this ball back to them before the half.
Ball came up nicely for Quintana. He's going the wrong direction.
This is a bad deal.
He could not get to the sideline in time, and now Alleman will have to start from a 10-yard line. Still a lot of time. 2 minutes and 14 seconds left. Remember, Rochester has two timeouts remaining. So if the Pioneers cannot move this ball,
yep,
there may be a timeout call. Here's Quintana, just was not pretty all the way through.
You don't want to give him the ball back here, Dave. You want to grind out a first down. And if you go in three at the half, you're gonna live to fight another day. I don't want to give Lunt the ball here at midfield.
Rochester fans sensing an opportunity for a big defensive play. Mendoza bursts through.
Big play on first down.
He gets 9 yards just like that.
Big play.
They will even stretch him out to the 21. That's close to the first down.
Just a little cutback by Mendoza. He takes it back behind the action. Big first down if they get it.
Actually, they gave it to him. They spotted that ball beyond the 21. Got a pretty good spot there. It is first down, all of them. Weatherall will get a couple.
Got to take a timeout, don't you, Dave?
I'm not sure. I'm afraid that if Alleman takes a timeout, they think, well, if something bad happens.
No, I'm talking about Rochester. I think he'd want to get it back, but I guess not.
Well, that's the respect that Derek Leonard
absolutely
shows as Alleman.
Absolutely.
And now you may see
gotta
a timeout.
Take it down.
Yep, there it is. Rochester takes it with a minute 26 to play and a half. It will be third down and long. That's a spot that Alleman does not want to be in. It's the second timeout called by Rochester. If the Rockets can get the ball back, they will have one remaining.
Yeah. Actually, if they stop him here, you want to take the timeout immediately.
True.
Take it immediately. You probably will get the ball then. You'll be kicking the ball with 1:20. And actually, Rochester doesn't need one on offense. They really don't need a timeout. The way they run it, they don't need a timeout. What they need to do is make sure that they don't walk it off here, either by converting the first down. They first have to stop them, and then they want to call a quick timeout and get that ball back.
So Rochester defense, it has played their best ball against the toughest teams. It's keyed by the Bermuda Triangle of Riley McMinn, Taylor Hill, and Dan Camp. In fact, this defense allowed 14 points against Jacksonville. That was 23 points below Jacksonville's season average. Their starters only allowed 7 points against Springfield, 35 below the average. And in that huge win early in the season over Sacred Heart, Griffin only allowed 10 points. They pulled 34 points below what the Cyclones normally average.
Now, they're very impressive on defense. They tackle well on the outside, very strong inside. All right, quick timeout.
Mendoza, the safe play up the middle. The timeout is called with 1:22 to play. Then we talk about that game, the game that Rochester played against Sacred Heart Griffin. What a huge game it was for the Leonard family. Ken Leonard, the head coach at Sacred Heart Griffin, his team had a 59-game winning streak in a Central State 8 conference. This is the first year Rochester joined that conference, smallest school in that conference. They played this year in Rochester. So father versus son, and it was a 13-10 win for the Sun and Rochester Rockets. And Derek Leonard said, obviously it was a special night given the circumstances, but just the way the community came out and for both sides, and the enthusiasm, the atmosphere, you just couldn't beat it.
Yeah, that's a fantastic, that's another, again, certainly something that I relate to, another great coaching legacy. Coach beating his father, a legend in the state of Illinois, you know, and being here in the finals. Dad's got to be awful proud of this one.
Did you ever have an opportunity to go up against father, son, brother?
Actually, no, and that's a good thing.
Okay.
we all went to different levels. We actually all went to different levels, and at the end, Dad could watch a high school game, a college game, and a pro game all in one weekend and see one of his sons coaching.
Jacob Sharp being helped off the field, and Derek Leonard was making an appeal to say, I really don't want my timeout because we had an injury on the field. Maybe that injury happened first before I even could call a timeout.
Yeah. Oh, that was smart ball. You wanted the timeout there. They're going to get the ball back with more than a minute to go with a very fast-paced offense. The kicker has had a terrible day. Now, I'm a little shallow there at the return guy. Now, don't let him kick it over your head. You want to get that ball back, you know, and get a short field here for Lunt.
It's a floater. Best to let this one
no,
hop.
Clear. Okay, here you go.
51 yards away from another score after just a 25-yard punt. Saw Jacob Sharp helped off the field. Sharp had some injuries this year. He suffered a high ankle sprain, and it didn't look good with Sharp, the 6'1", 215-pounder, being helped off the field. So plenty of time here for Wes Lunt and this Rochester offense. They have scored one touchdown on a pass.
And here's that cluster again, and here's where they've been throwing that layer pass. They'll throw three receivers to the outside. There's the layer to number three. Oh, he threw it away from him.
Grant will make the catch on the near sideline.
Yeah, I never have trouble throwing to Grant. I like him a lot, whether he's inside or outside. Throwing layers to their left and individuals to their right.
Fifth reception of the night for Grant.
There's the layer.
First down, Gunter will scoot out of bounds and stops the clock with 1:06 to play.
That's pretty sharp right now. They're sending one guy deep, one guy medium out, one guy short out, and if they hit it, then they can stop the clock. All those patterns will take you to the sidelines. I call them layers, high and low layers out here.
Looking once again for Grant. It's the second time he has missed. Zachary Grant.
Intended for Grant.
Good coverage by Quintana there, right on top of him. That was smart. If you're not gonna complete it in this situation, put it out either to the outside on the receiver, either catches it or you throw it out of bounds. You don't let the defender get a piece of it.
Wes Lunt, how about his numbers this year? We talk about his yardage numbers. 30 touchdowns. You know how many interceptions he's thrown, folks? Three.
He's impressive. He's as advertised, as I said before. There's no throw he can't make. He's athletic and he does it effortlessly. Here he comes on the move. Good pressure.
Max Mendoza was really coming harder. Check that. That was Tanner Wood that was creating the heat.
Good job by Tanner. Yeah, he got on top of him. So now we're in a third and 10.
John Perry getting that leg loosened up. Possibly another attempt. He just knocked home a 25-yard field goal a little while ago. Lunt hits, he throws.
Oh,
it's picked up.
Good pressure. That's two plays in a row, Dave, where they got a piece of him, and that time they forced it. They forced the interception. Man, that's a great way to end it for Alleman. They stay in the ball game. They go in that second half with a little bit of confidence and get ready to fight another day. Let's see the pressure coming here. Coming off that right side, they got him. They hit him well.
Michael Peters with the interception for Alleman. And he returns it 16 yards to the 45-yard line. Bolin with room to run. Heads for the sidelines.
Just an efficient guy. He's a field general. Doesn't make bad decisions. Alleman going to their own version of layers to the sidelines, trying to either hit it or run it. Real smart by Bolin to get that ball out of bounds.
6'1", 185-pound senior. He has the ball at midfield. 41 seconds left. His team's down by three here in the first half.
Now you got the trips to the left now to the field. He's going to roll this way.
And out of
good
bounds.
Play. Nice, efficient out cut.
He got it to Ryan Sheely.
Good route by Sheely. Defense playing off like they're going in this situation. Nice out cut on the run, running to your left.
Alleman getting to the line.
Alleman fast tempo now.
They feel it, don't they?
They feel it.
And Weatherall, can he get to the sideline?
Oh, great job. Great job.
Wow. That was a dead out sprint to the sideline by Weatherall.
Sprint to the sidelines. Good throw by Bolin. I mean, they go from just grinding it out to wide open. Who would have thought?
Alleman with one timeout remaining. They needed the clock to stop, and Weatherall did it with 31 seconds to play in the half.
One thing that was huge is getting pressure on the quarterback, getting pressure on Wes Lunt, and forcing a bad play. You talk about a catalyst now. You talk about something that can really fire a team up and change momentum. Here's a guy that's untouched for almost two quarters, and all of a sudden you force two bad throws, one for an interception. You gain confidence on defense.
Second and less than a yard. And they get the first down, except I don't know.
It looked like somebody jumped on that right side.
There's a flag on the far side of the field. And our official
illegal procedure.
We'll say it's 5 yards going against Alleman. Not what Dave DeJager wanted to see. DeJager coaching in his second state championship game, lost to Sacred Heart Griffin in 2005. And Alleman may need to take a timeout here as Sheely catches that one with 21 seconds on the clock down to 20. And they'll use their final timeout right here. 16 to play. It'll be third down and a yard, but you've got to look for a little bit more here.
Yeah. 16 seconds, no timeouts. You almost have to put it in the end zone.
Patrick Ewald, the kicker for Alleman. He has 4 field goals this season. Had a tough night in the punting game, but you'd have to throw that quick out, get out of bounds for him to get an opportunity,
yeah,
or as you say.
Very difficult. We used to say under 20 seconds. Now this is a little bit further, but we were under seconds from the 20-yard line. We would tell our guys every throw has to go
back
in the
to tight end. So, hey, John Gilson.
Yeah.
Do that tight end side, you got to jack him good.
We have two ways to do it.
They may run next, and then right you now. Play X next play. Yeah. All right.
You're looking for the throwing numbers for Tim Bolin. He has thrown 11 touchdown passes this season. Only thrown 3 interceptions. It was a big interception by Peters that stopped the Rochester drive and enabled Alleman to come down here the final moments of the first half.
I think, Dave, they'll work that layers to the outside and try to get one of those guys, probably take 2 plays, try to get one of them to the completion and take it out of bounds. They got 3 receivers to that side. They've been running the layer patterns out there.
Bolin's ready. Pocket collapses. Down he goes. Kyle Kremitsky hit him first.
Can't stop it.
Now, Alleman wants to get everybody back so they can spike it. I don't think that's going to happen.
No.
Our first half will come to an end. So Rochester happy that they were able to deny Alleman a chance for a score. On the other side, Alleman thrilled that they kept Rochester out of the end zone in the final moments of the first half. You take a look at momentum on either side. Right now, you have to believe that Alleman feels a little bit better about themselves.
I think so, because when you play a high-powered offense like Rochester, you're on your heels. And even though Rochester didn't score, they moved the ball at will. And then all of a sudden, that turned around a little bit. They stopped them, and then the pressure on the quarterback, awesome.
Let's go down to Aaron Bennett. He has Derek Leonard.
All right, Coach, you're up 10-7 heading into halftime. I know it's a position you'd like to be in, but I have a feeling we haven't seen the best yet from your offense in this game.
Yeah, I mean, we killed ourselves. We made some mistakes, had some opportunities that we didn't, that we didn't turn in, basically. And, that's the worst half of football I think we've played. And so it's a blessing to have the lead. But we got to have a better half, or they're going to beat us. So but if we come out and play, we'll be all right.
Coach, thanks a lot. Good luck in the second half. Rochester with a 10-7 lead at half. Guys, back to you.
If I'm coaching Alleman, I'm happy as hell.
And Derek Leonard, not so much. Your halftime score finds Leonard's Rockets on top, 10-7. We're at the half, Memorial Stadium. The 2010 IHSA Football Championship brought to you by Country Financial.
We are back at the 2010 IHSA State Football Championships. We're at halftime of the Class 4A game, Rochester with a 10-7 lead over Rock Island Alleman. I'm joined right now by the IHSA Executive Director, Marty Hickman. We've had some great football today so far. What are your thoughts on today's action?
Well, we have. The first couple of games got a little bit out of hand, but the 3A game was one of the great IHSA games, and this one's shaping up to be the same thing.
And we got four more games tomorrow. Some of Chicagoland's best teams coming down. Team from the Springfield area, more from Rockford area. What are you looking forward to tomorrow?
I think we've got some great games. You know, Chatham probably a little bit of a surprise. People probably weren't picking them early, but, you know, Dan, Coach Rourke's really got them playing well, and they'll play a great Montini team, so that'll be fun. And then in 6A, I think Boylan hasn't been here for a while, and I think it's the first time Marmion's ever been here, so that'll be exciting. And then Wheaton-Warrenville South and Lake Zurich could be a classic game.
And in recent years, you know, this event's really turned into an event for the fans, too, with Tent City and everything there. Just talk about how this, you know, event has kind of grown into a cultural event here in Champaign Urbana.
Well, I tell you what, the Visitors and Convention Bureau here in the community in general has really embraced the tournament. Like you said, Tent City, all the things that go on out there for the fans. And it is more of an event than just a football game. People come here early, stay late, and really enjoy themselves.
And it's been a great season, really, for all the fall sports all around, some volleyball and swimming and diving and everything so far.
Well, we've had fantastic weather, one, for football, which really makes things nice. And then at our volleyball tournament, we had some great stories with Cary Grove coming in undefeated and little old Scales Mound coming in with 76 kids in their high school and finishing second, really 1 point away from being a state champion. So, yeah, it's been a great fall. Cross country was fabulous. Swimming and diving is always a great event. So we're excited about how the fall has been.
All right, Marty, thanks a lot. Marty Hickman, Executive Director of the IHSA. We are at halftime of the Class 4A game. Rochester with a 10-7 lead over Alleman. We're back with more football after this.
It's a tight one here at the half at Memorial Stadium in your 4A championship ball game at the half. Rochester leading Alleman 10-7. Happy you've joined us, everybody. Good to have you with us here on a very crisp and cold night here in Champaign. I'm Dave Bernhard, along with former NFL head coach Rick Venturi. And Rick, head coach for the New Orleans Saints, head coach for the Indianapolis Colts, defensive coordinator, all about the National Football League. You played the greatest show on turf, the Rams, and you had success because?
Well, one of the things that we emphasize to our guys, and I think Alleman's done a good job of this, is withstand the early onslaught of a fast-paced team. Fast-paced team like Rochester is going to come out, they're going to come after you, they're going to get yards, and they may score early. Don't lose your poise. Keep fighting. The game will slow down. And in Alleman's case, which used to happen to us when I was in New Orleans against the Rams, they were able to turn the momentum around. Now, whether they can keep it is another thought. But they were able to get pressure at the end of the second half. They didn't get any in the first half. So they got to feel good about themselves, and they got to go back to their normal way. Again, make first downs, keep the ball away from them. And, you know, on the other side of it, Rochester's got to go back and get the ball to their top guys. Just do what they do and don't panic, you know, because what happens sometimes when you're a great high-powered offense and you're sitting on the bench a lot, you get frustrated and you tend to do some silly things. So they've got to keep their cool as well.
Let's take a look at our first half highlights. 10-7 is our halftime score. Not a lot of points on the board. Wes Lunt, he's a man who can make things happen. So can number 27. That's Colton Glazebrook. He'll take this one 23 yards for a touchdown, a couple of shifty moves, and it's an early 7-0 lead for the Rockets. And then the Alleman Pioneers come right on back. Kevin Weatherall from about 3 yards out. We're tied at 7. All of a sudden, the Rochester fans get a little anxious. Alleman struggling, getting to the 40-yard line. Not happy about the play there by Gland, and he sets up John Perry's field goal, and that is the difference in our game. A 25-yarder from Perry. Our first half statistics in this ball game: 175 yards and 13 first downs for Rochester to 95 yards for Alleman. Penalties did become key in that one touchdown drive for Rock Island Alleman. 3 penalties total at 25 yards for Rochester.
Well, there's no doubt about it. Penalties and drop balls. A couple drop balls and a couple penalties, but that's what you do. If you get a team like this ahead, you know, behind in the count, then you've got a chance. It's like playing with 3 downs instead of 4. So again, it's going to be really interesting whether Alleman can capitalize on that last little bit of momentum or whether they can. I'm sure that Rochester will go in, try to get it short, and you know what a team like that's going to do? They're going to come out even faster. I mean, I know what the coaches are telling them. They got to go faster. You got to get after these guys. Don't let them get lined up. So we'll be holding our breath here in the second half.
It's been a good one through the first 2 quarters. Stay right there. We've got the second half coming up. Rochester and Rock Island, all of them in a 3-pointer at the half. Alleman, Rochester, 2 undefeated teams battling it out here in the 4A championship. Let's go downstairs to Aaron Bennett.
We are here with Alleman head coach Dave DeJager, his team down 10-7 right now at half. Coach, a couple of big defensive stands for you guys there late in the second quarter. You held Rochester to a field goal and then the big interception. There is some momentum there you guys can carry over maybe?
Yeah, we hope so. You know, they're a heck of an offense, and we're trying to finally got a little bit pressure on there at the end of the second half, and that helped us a little bit. But yeah, it's you know, we got to figure out, we got to stop the run first. I mean, that's really been the big thing is, you know, they've been able to run the ball pretty effectively out of that stuff. And, you know, they're really tough to stop when they're able to run and pass against you. So we need to do a better job of stopping the run and then, you know, make sure we tackle in the open field.
Coach, thanks a lot. Good luck in the second half.
Thank you.
Alleman head coach Dave DeJager, his team down 10-7 as we get ready to start the second half.
Number 1 versus number 2 in the high school football rankings, but in 2 quarters there will truly be only number 1, the 4A championship. Rock Island Alleman and Rochester Rockets.
Well, it's the same thing, Dave. When we start this second half now, that the first couple series tells you a lot. You know, you're going to go in, you're going to adjust, and you're going to see who comes out with the best plan. Again, you know, with Rochester, it's going to be fast-paced, and I'll be interested to see. I think Alleman will go back to their option attack, and interesting to see how they change the perimeter to try to get some edges, particularly for Quintana.
One of the things that we have talked about and right from the top is how Alleman defensively might have to scramble a little bit. They looked running some people in and off the field personnel-wise. Have they gotten into a flow defensively?
I think they got in a little bit of flow. They were struggling early. And honestly, from a defensive perspective, the hardest thing to defend is no huddle with personnel changes. No huddle in one grouping is not hard to handle. No huddle with personnel groupings, you have to make a decision. Do I substitute? Do I not? I got to a point late in my career where I just decided that the substitution was actually harder than what you got out of it. So I tried to get a ratio that could out there probably play a team like this in nickel all night.
Rochester to get their hands on the ball first here as we start the second half. The Rockets lead by a field goal.
Rochester wants to get this ball and go with it. I think they're disappointed that they don't have more on the scoreboard. They know they've missed some opportunities. So I think they're going to put their pedal to the metal here.
That's exactly how Glazebrook approached that kickoff return. Right up the middle he goes for 23. Glazebrook now will come split out here to the near left side.
Yeah, see, they have their 3 wideouts to one side. And and they got Grant in there on the inside where I like him. I think you can make a living to him on the inside, and that's what they do. They put the back and tight end this side, and then they've got the three out there. They got the three wideouts out there to one side. Actually, that's Grant on the outside.
They'll go here to Glazebrook. And if he can get a block, he has a chance. Glazebrook splits three defenders. And he may go.
Oh, what a good play.
My goodness. Inside the 20-yard line, but so many great things happening on that first play.
He's angry at himself, but it's a heck of a play. I guess that's smart. Just like the first one, this is the two biggest plays of the night are the quick screens. The slow screen to Glazebrook and then the quick one right out here. That's the way to get her started.
Watch him move right here. And another one there.
He is excellent in loose play. Now they come back with the run to him.
He gets to the 10-yard line. That pass play goes for 62 yards.
This must be the second half Glazebrook game plan, it looks to me like.
Rockets more than ready to go right now. Second and five from the 10-yard line of Alleman. Glazebrook powers forward.
Same thing. They just flipped it. They just flipped the side. Going to run that power guard tackle trap. And they're gonna run with their horse now.
First and goal from the one. And that didn't take long.
Well,
50 seconds into the third quarter, Rochester goes on top 16-7.
That's exactly what they wanted to do. You know, that's what they talked about. Let's get out. Let's get this thing going. Let's get that ball in the end zone. And they did a heck of a job.
A 23-yard kickoff return followed by a 62-yard touchdown pass, another short run, and then this. For Colton Glazebrook, his second touchdown of the night. The first one came in the air, this on the ground. For Glazebrook, his 37th and 38th touchdowns of the season. Perry for the extra point. And just like that, we have a 10-point game. Rochester 17, Rock Island Alleman 7. Colton Glazebrook, senior, another All-State player. Only needed a yard, he got just a wee bit more, and Rochester gives Derek Leonard something to be happy about. He was not too happy going into the locker room.
I have a feeling Coach Leonard read the riot act there. That was a different ball club. But again, if you get the ball in Glazebrook's hands in loose play, get him out in space, He's pretty hard to get down now. He'll make you miss, get some linemen out in front of him and create a little bit of a wall for him.
You know, now on the flip side here for Alleman, it isn't like they have to go play catch up right now.
They have to be what they are. They've got to just continue to pound it out and go down and get a touchdown and get within three and whatever it takes. And you're exactly right, Dave. The last thing you want to do is change who you are, panic in this situation, and think you got to get it back quick. First of all, you're not going to get it back quick, so stay calm and do what you do.
Perry was working on his kickoffs. He came out early at the half. He was just running them down the field. Didn't put it up in the air, just kind of wanted to line drive it down the field. Let's see what he does here. He hits it pretty good from the eight. Quintana to the 28. 20 yards on the return. Rock Island Alleman didn't really anticipate getting their hands on the ball as quickly as they did here, as run right up the back here of Justin Quintana. This young man, he has his future planned out ahead of him. Quintana has already enlisted in the Marines. Tough-minded kid.
Well, this is a really important series here. They had momentum, let it get away quickly there in the first series, and now they've got to stay in this thing. They can't, they're down 10, they're okay, they can't go down any further.
Mendoza will go backwards. He is just ridden down.
Good tackle by Grant. I mean, that's as fine a fundamental tackle as you're gonna see.
It will give Mendoza forward progress a yard to the 29.
Grant and Gunter are two guys that really are all-purpose players. We've seen a lot of that today. Those two guys are big-time both-way players, two-way players.
Bolins to the air. Tough pass, short hops it in. Now it's third down and nine. So the stop on first down sets up the incomplete pass and third and long.
Yeah, Alleman is not, you know, they don't play good behind in the count. It's, you know, I think Bowen manipulates the offense well, but it's just not their style.
You have a feeling right here that the third down conversion could be very necessary for the Pioneers. Rochester fans sensing a kill here early in the third quarter. Completion to Sheely. First down, Sheely giving ground. He stays in the first down yardage. I thought he was going backwards behind the line, but it's a first down. Rock Island Alleman, 11-yard pickup.
Big play. Just like you said, that's critical at this stage in the game to stay in it and not get far behind. And Bowen does a good job. I mean, he rolls out. Nice tight spiral there in the curl area. Made the key first down.
Geely, the favorite target of Tim Bolin this year, came into the game with 32 catches for 422 yards. Mendoza for two. Well, this gives Rock Island Alleman a little bit of breathing room here. Enables him to get kind of back in offensive rhythm.
And again, you know, in their offense, you've got to run the fullback, even though there are times when it looks like you're not going to make very much, because the only way you can clear those options to the outside is getting the freeze with the fullback. Fullback freezing the defense. This is a little bit of a passing formation, 3-by-1 for them. A little roll out, layers on the sidelines. Hit the short guy. You got three guys deep, three different layers. Gets Quintana out there.
Gain of 10 and a first down into Rochester territory.
He's got Witherall on that second level. He's got Quintana on the short level, and he's driving off with Sheeland. So he's putting his best players in a row and rolling to them, which shortens the distance of the throw. Oh, back to the power bone. We saw that in the first game. Shift it out. Okay, back to his passing set, 3-by-1.
The pitch to Witherall. Being chased and being tracked down from behind. You're not going to run away from Dan Camp, 5'11", 195-pound senior linebacker. Camp, a three-year starter. Great work ethic, great leadership for Camp.
Very productive football player all season long. A lot of tackles, excellent, excellent speed right there and effort to the ball. Showed great range there.
Derek Leonard predicts that Camp is either going to be a comedian or a great coach. Just so energetic and positive. On second and six, Bolin decides to pitch and being cut down by Travis Everly.
Good play by Everly on the perimeter. Great play. And sometimes, Dave, coaches do have to be comedians, so might not be a bad attribute.
Look at that play by Everly on Witherall. A loss of a couple.
They have really tackled well, that is Rochester. They've tackled extremely well on the perimeter, which is the key to stopping option football. You've got to be able to tackle on the perimeter. They try to create one-on-ones out there.
Look out! Oh, that would have gone for six. Blake Glenn would love to have had that one back. Whoa.
Wow.
Take a look at this.
Dodged a bullet on this one. I don't know if that was a miscommunications because the receivers went flat and up, and Bolin threw it as if there were going to be a guy in the out there. That's got to be a miscommunication between quarterback and receivers.
Now Bland will set back up as Alleman will have to punt. good punt by Ewald here. Kind of hopped as he get. It will work out perfectly. And now it becomes very interesting with 7:27 to play in the third quarter. Rochester up by 10 following a 40-yard punt by Patrick Ewald. The Rockets back on the field looking to build on this 10-point lead. From the 4-yard line is where Rochester will start this drive. Their last drive only took 4 plays to a score as we started the third quarter with that 1-yard touchdown dive by Colton Glazebrook. Go from an eye here to get it started.
Yeah, they got him backed up a little bit, so they go traditional eye formation. Power there. No, nothing going there. I think it's very important for Alleman here to stop him. Stop him inside that 10-yard line. Make him kick from in there.
Ryan O'Keefe on the step.
I'll give you an interesting statistic about stopping a team backed up here in a second.
After a yard loss, play action from his own end zone. Lunt going deep, and it's too deep.
In the National Football League, this is an interesting statistic for the fans. If you take over, if a team takes over inside their own 10, and you force a punt inside that 10-yard line, the percentage of scoring a field goal or touchdown is 90% in the National Football League. So this is huge right here. This is huge. If you stop him here, you shorten the field, and you get yourself a team like Rock Island Alleman, you put yourself in 4-down territory. You don't want to let them out of here.
Lunt needs 11 yards for a first down. Quick slant
quick
to Grant.
Screen, great call.
And he should have
it. Got it. That was an excellent call. That's the bubble screen when you run inside out, the drive screen, they come right back in. Nice call, good execution. Because it's tough to get out of there. That was a good call. Now they get a little breathing room, as you say.
13 yards in the completion from Lunt to Grant. Grant now with 6 catches this evening for 60 yards.
If I'm Rochester, I'm living with Glazebrook and Grant. Ball's on the ground. Ball's on the ground. I think he rolled him down.
Coming hard was Matthew Carruthers. Carruthers, 6'3", senior defensive end. Lunt.
Ooh. Good job. Wow. Lunt took, that's the third time he basically took the read off that play, the quarterback read off the give. Unfortunately, right into Big Carruthers.
Another loss of yardage. Ooh, Lunt, nice catch there.
Okay.
All right, let's think if Wes Lunt is not 6'5" and a great athlete who can make a one-handed snag. Here it is.
Okay, Dave, we got him in another tough situation. That was a great play just to get rid of it. But, you know, those are things now that they're 3rd and 13.
They got the first one on 3rd and 11. Lunt on the run.
Oh,
Everly just sitting there waiting for it. And that was the one place that Everly knew the ball was coming to, and that's where Lunt put it.
You gotta like Wes Lunt on that play. Now that is coming out full tilt to your left and throwing a dead spot out right there. That's big time talent.
Saw Everly just sitting on his knees waiting for
the ball.
15-yard completion, here come the Rockets.
And he buried it in his chest, he buried it.
Glazebrook back to join Lunt in the backfield, and he'll get the carry and gets a big hole. And look out, he's got speed. Glazebrook. Sheely tracks him down, but not until Colton Glazebrook gets to the 11-yard line.
Well blocked, and he took it.
63 yards on the run for Colton Glazebrook.
Alleman, the Pioneers got a little wide there to rush the passer. They came with the trap, and he hit it, and he was even and leaving there.
Glazebrook now with 152 yards rushing, 75 receiving.
Oh.
And Glazebrook's going in again.
Excellent design. They ran that little counter action, which they do off the eye. He got the edge. You're not going to get him down. He's pretty special.
Third touchdown run of the day. Third touchdown scored by Glazebrook today. And he just caught his breath, got back up, and scampers in from 11 yards. Now this is Glazebrook, who earlier in the playoffs set a single game state postseason record against Effingham when he scored 6 touchdowns against the Flaming Hearts, and that came on just 12 carries. Perry, extra point, is good. 2 touchdowns scored here in the third quarter for Rochester. This a 96-yard drive capped off by Glazebrook's third touchdown of the night.
Good job, really good job of blocking by Rochester. And the big boys up front, particularly Odell pulling around there as big as he is, pulling that tackle all the way around, leading him around the edge. That was really good football. I guess that game plan pretty much unfolded at the half. It's going to be Glazebrook, Glazebrook, and a little bit more Glazebrook.
On that drive, Rochester converted a third down and 12 and a third down and 14, both of those deep in their own territory.
Yeah, and the third and 11 was just, it was a really nice call on the quick screen. And the third and 13 was a big time quarterback getting out to his left and throwing a dart in there for a first down. That was impressive. That was impressive.
The happy bunch of folks right there from Rochester. On the other side, you got a quick look at Dave DeJager, and he glanced at the clock. 5:18, third quarter. He's down 24-7. He needs to make something happen here in a hurry. On the dead run, Quintana.
Well, I think now he's got to get in that 3-by-1. He's got a roll. Bowen's throwing the ball pretty well tonight. You know, you want to get it. You want to get it to those two guys, those two top guys, Quintana and Witherall. And I think take your chances.
21 yard return to the 29. 24 points scored by Rochester here tonight. The high number that Alleman has given up all year. Their previous high was 20 points. The quarterfinals against Richmond Burton. Well defended.
Oh, well defended. Man. Another good play on the perimeter.
Everly will get credit for the tackle, but there were 3 other Rockets out there that set it all up.
Another real good perimeter tackle by the secondary. Everly just really good form. He kind of feathered there on the option, burst out to the pitch. Just been some really good tackling on the edge. And we've said it all night, that's the key to stopping the option. Really good tacklers. Really got to be impressed with Rochester fundamentally on defense.
Bowen in trouble. Here they come. Kyle Kremitsky will get credit for the sack. He had help from about 3 other folks, including number 79, Ryan Broglund.
The Pioneers got their oar in some rough ground right now. They're going to have to settle down here. Now's a good time if you got a screen in your arsenal. Try to get it to one of those 2 good backs and see if they can run for it.
You need 19 yards for a first down. Bolin has room to run if he wants it.
Oh, another good tackle.
Open field by John Gilson.
That Gilson came up, and I mean they're stinging him. When they're hitting him, I mean they're hitting him with a purpose.
Obviously, with a 24-7 lead, you would have a little more life in your step, but this defense here in the second half for Rochester looks so much quicker than they did in the first half. Tim Boland, not a great possession for his club. And there's your yardage numbers really adding up for Rochester, 341 yards. A We still have 3 minutes to play in the third quarter. Yet another punt for the Pioneers. Good field position for Rochester. They'll start from their own 44. It's a happy bunch of Rochester Rockets. Alleman will have to regroup defensively, and that one flat out cold. 24-7 Rochester. Dave Fernhardt along with Rick Venturi here in your 4A championship game. Rick will join Lee Hall for Class 5A and 6A starting at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. Jack McInerney and I will be high atop Memorial Stadium for your 7A and 8A games tomorrow night. So 12 hours of football today, 12 hours tomorrow, 8 state champions when we're all done.
Well, Dave, now we're going to find out what ball control is to Rochester.
Lunt.
Lunt on the read. That's a read play off of the 20, off the give to Glazebrook.
You know, and that's a good point. Okay, you're up 24-7. Do you have ball control in this offense?
This is what we find out. This is where they do still have a really good running game to Glazebrook, and a lot of quick screens in this situation are like runs. I think Alleman's got to turn up the temperature here. They got to start bringing some heat here. There's the quick screens.
Good play on the outside. Kevin Weatherall.
Weatherall, yeah. Very, very good defensive football player.
Well, you talk about getting pressure on Lunt. That only happened at the end of the first half. But as quickly as the ball is snapped and as quickly as Lunt gets rid of it.
It's very, very difficult. It really is. And one of the ways they control it is with that trap game to 27 to Glazebrook and then the quick screens outside. That's their two blitz beaters, actually. Now they cluster them up in there. Gonna run layers. Whoa.
That was into traffic. They were looking for Gunter. And it will be fourth down. That one's a little dangerous there for a moment.
Well, we got a good idea what ball control was. That's a trap, a screen, in and out. Not exactly the Woody Hayes beat the clock on you.
Lunt also is the punter. We see a lot of quarterbacks here today that are also the punters for their respective teams. He'll just punch it down inside the 30-yard line. 35 yards on that kick from Lunt. 1:37 to play in the third quarter. Alleman hands back on the ball. They are just about in a must-score situation here on this particular possession.
Yeah, she's winding down. We got to keep going here. And we got to get the ball on the perimeter, either with the option or the rollout passes.
This is good team speed defense for Rochester as Wes Lunt will put that jacket up, that right arm loose. Lunt tonight, 15 of 30, 186 yards, he's thrown an interception, also a touchdown. Glazebrook is rushed for 163 yards. The other side, just 124 yards of offense for Rock Island Alleman. Nothing doing for Bolin.
Bolin looked back after the play. I think he was supposed to have a pitch man out there, and I think they blew it. He looked back like, where are you, man? Don't leave me out here by myself. You got to be impressed, though, with not just Rochester offense, but a Rochester defense has been equally impressive. And this is not an easy offense to play. The triple option puts a lot of pressure, a lot of stress on you, and they've held up well. Particularly impressive is their tackling, the simple tackling, which is, you know, that wins games in high school, in college, and in the National Football League. People don't realize how the little things win at all levels. And you know, just tackling is everything in defensive football.
You speak of the defense against the offense of Rock Island. This is not an offense that Rochester will see over the course of a season.
No, and they've, you know, because they've played against a lot of spreads, Rochester, they've actually played a lot of nickel. And it was interesting to me to see tonight how they were going to defend it. But that gang has really come up with a good game plan.
Second down and long. Boland can't get much of anything. He seems to be making decent decisions. The problem is there seem to be about 15 white jerseys on the field.
Yeah, they're just, you know, they're really pursuing to the ball, and they're making sure that the quarterback has to go through all. What I like they're doing is they're stopping everything from inside out. One thing that you make a mistake on the option is when you start stopping things from outside in, things pop on you. You watch Oregon, you watch Navy, you watch these teams that run it. At the end of the day, they make all these big plays right up the middle. So they're not going to let that happen.
Riley McMinn, a little bit of problem with his helmet. He is ready to go. McMinn had a big sack early in this game. He's headed to the University of Iowa. And he runs right into Boland. Riley McMinn was a big kid. And you're talking about, you know, you say, oh, you're a big kid in fifth grade. How about 6 feet, 3 inches tall in fifth grade? They thought he'd be a basketball star in high school. They tried him at several different positions on the football field as a freshman, and they settled on defensive end.
Well, the Hawks are going to like him. My good friend Kirk Ferentz is the coach of the Hawks, and they do a good job with guys like Riley. They like guys that are raw, have a lot ahead of them, and they'll bring him along. He'll be outstanding there.
Ewald just gets that one away.
Ewald's starting to get a workout on his day. He's starting to get a workout.
And with that kick, we have reached the end of the third quarter. Ewald gets a 41-yarder off, but it's two touchdowns in the third quarter that has stretched this lead to 24-7. Rochester, first time state finals, looking for the title. Have to admire those Alleman fans sticking it out here. It's been a very, very cold day here and a cold evening tonight. Champaign, your team's down by 17. It's colder yet. We start the fourth quarter. Rochester with it. Glazebrook, he's had a big night, three touchdowns already, 163 yards in the ground, 75 more in the air. Got about five on first down.
And they're in a hurry.
Well, you know, I was just going to say, Rick.
They're in a hurry.
The break between quarters, obviously with television playing a part, longer than in a regular high school game, you could see how antsy. Rochester was between quarters. They wanted to go.
One thing I noticed, too, is the Rochester coaches have had great energy in the second half. When the defense stopped them, I mean, they met those guys halfway coming off. And, you know, obviously, they made a commitment at the half. I'm a little biased. Coach Eric Warren on defense was one of my dad's greatest football players at Pekin High School. So I've been kind of following those guys, but they've been impressive. Now, again, what I like here is the traps and the quick screens with the lead. Those are relatively safe plays. And again, those quick screens are very much like runs. Now Glazebrook, he's shifting him back in because he's going to run the trap probably to this side. Here it comes. Most of the time that trap is a check with me play where they allow West to look at the front and decide which is the ideal side to trap, and boom, they come back with it.
One of the few times Glazebrook today has not gotten positive yardage.
This is where you want West to milk the shot clock, though. Really, I think a good tempo team, a spread, no huddle team, needs to be able to go fast pace, and they need to be able to milk it when they have to.
2 yards on that completion to Glazebrook. Our players flying all over this field. Lunt very casually stands there. Receivers flip-flop sides. What about that? Over the middle. Enough for the first down. Again on the catch, Blake Gland. He had an opportunity earlier in the game for an interception return for a score. Couldn't hang on, but Gand will get himself a first down.
Nice job. Threw it underneath. Didn't want to do anything silly with the ball. Catch and run play. Made a guy miss. Good job.
field we go to the 40-yard line on the reception that time, Michael Gunter. Five different receivers have caught passes tonight from West Lunt, and that's just a typical Rochester game.
And this has been a really nice showcase game for Wes. Again, he does everything effortlessly. There isn't a ball that he can't throw. He can throw it any spot, anywhere, and he's got good mobility.
Folks, Central Illinois knew what West Lunt was all about. Now a statewide audience can tell as well, and he's just a junior.
They really do. You know, I've had the pleasure all season long to watch the rookie Sam Bradford have come in from Oklahoma and have a great year, played in an offense like this one. You know, and there's similarities on this kid. This kid does it with poise. He does it easy and very, very impressive. You know, and this is hard to, you know, this is not that easy to coach that. These guys have done a great job. When you coach that no huddle and that spread multiple passing offense, that takes a lot of good coaching.
Rochester will take the timeout. It comes with 9:23. They're counting down the minutes to their first state football title. These are the 2010 IHSA football championships, brought to you by Country Financial. Lights shining brightly here at Memorial Stadium. In a little bit, they will shut them down, and we'll get back here at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning under what we're told is going to be bright, sunny skies. It'll be a little bit cold. Dave Bernhardt and Rick Venturi with you. A flag comes out following the timeout, and we check time of possession. It's one of those statistics. Night doesn't mean a whole lot. Rock Island Alleman with 22 minutes and 5 seconds. Rochester, 16:32. And a 24-7 lead for Rochester.
Illegal
picks
procedure.
Up their fourth penalty of the
on
night.
On the offense.
Third and 8. A motion from Grant. Misfires, looking for Everly.
Got a little greedy right there. He might have wanted to just check that down to Grant. They got good deep coverage on here. I think if he had that one back, he would probably just kick it out to Grant in a flat.
A fourth down and 8 with the ball sitting at about the 43-yard line. Rochester will go for it. Dead Lunt, who doubles as a punter with a quick little kick, and is he going to get? Nope, it's going to bounce in there.
As you said, though, that you see a lot of these quarterbacks today. A lot of quarterbacks are the kickers, and you talk about a great advantage there. You can't rush it, you can't do anything with it, and unfortunately, he didn't put it and stop it. But they still got it down there.
Now let's give credit to the Alleman defense. You know, you look at the board. Rochester has 24 points. Well, they come in averaging 43 points per game, and to hold this attack to 24 with 9 minutes left in the game is
no. That's exactly right. They battled their tails off, and that's hard to do as you get behind.
Boland on the run, and what will they call on this? Gunter has the ball. Is it an interception or was he out of bounds? Out of bounds. They had no. He just stood there saying, well, I caught it.
The biggest problem is Alleman just hasn't been able to sustain anything in the second half. You know, they did a pretty good job in the first half, at least eating some clock and staying in there close. But Rochester just explosively came out with Glazebrook there and changed the whole venue.
And a second down and 10. The Rochester fans saw the replay of that, thought that Gunter had a clean interception. Bull in trouble. Down he goes. Chase Walker gets him. Number 57, a 6 foot, 210 pound senior. And Rochester is cutting it loose right now. Well, Walker just kept on coming.
Really impressive second half.
Well, we heard Derek Leonard say that it was the worst half of football in the first half. They're making up for that now. That's the fifth sack today by Rochester's defense. Mendoza the carry. He hasn't had an opportunity to carry much here with the Pioneers falling behind in the second half.
Somehow, I think, Dave, I think Derek was practicing that speech for the half of this player.
I think
he very well got that across to them.
Derek Leonard, the son of legendary head coach Ken Leonard. I know that Derek at times would like to just stand on his own sometimes, as you know, Rick. That shadow looms forever, but Derek in his sixth year, 45 wins and 20 losses, 12-1 last year, and of course 13-0 coming into this one.
Yeah, and he's going to be right out of that shadow in a minute, in a few minutes.
Well, you know, and his dad, who is now in the same conference as Derek, isn't quite helping him quite as much as he did in the
no,
past.
I don't think so.
But he is enjoying the ride that Derek has given him this year.
Yeah.
And the Rochester fans really, really feeling
it now.
Coming up tomorrow, four more games of football. 5A football, you will have Montini taking on Chatham Glenwood, another team very close to the Springfield and Rochester area. 6A, Marmion will take on Boyland as we get ourselves all prepared for day number two. There is your 5A game. That's a 10 o'clock kickoff. Make sure you're with us here. The IHSA Television Network and ESPN3.com. So very happy to be part of ESPN3.com for all of these games. First time ever from the ESPN family of networks at a state championship have been decided on ESPN3.com. So that's 5A. 6A will be Marion and Rockford Boylan, and 7A Lake Zurich and Wheaton Warrenville South. And our wrap-up tomorrow night will be the 8A contest between Maine South looking for their third state title in a row against Mount Carmel. That should really shape up, Rick, as a great, great day of football tomorrow.
Oh, my goodness.
It's third down and 10 here for Alleman. Motion from Wetherill. And crushed to the ground.
They are turning it loose now.
How about 276 pounds falling on you? That's Ryan Broglin.
They are active on defense. The tackle.
Well, that offensive line for Alleman starting to get worn down now by the size and quickness of that front of Rochester. Ewald, a busy man tonight. Gets his kick away, and another poor kick hits out of bounds, and Rochester's going to get this ball at the 34-yard line. Dave DeJager knew he was going to be up against it tonight. He knew a lot of things had to go very well for him, and when several different things have to line up perfectly for you, it's tough to make it happen.
Yeah, they were on a real tight rope. You know, the formula was basically what they did in the first half. They stayed really close by playing tenacious and hanging in there. And they got some breaks, a couple drop balls, penalties. But the second half, Rochester's just come out and taking it over from the first play.
Glazebrook from the eye gets a nice block to the outside. Glazebrook, a stiff arm, and he could not stay in. He stepped out at about the 16-yard line.
And the thing that coach did is he came right out in the second half, and they put it in Glazebrook's hands. And he's totally turned it around. Actually, that first screen of the second half just really was a backbreaker. It just totally changed the momentum of the whole football game, and they needed to do it, and they did it. And they always say, when you got a good horse, ride him, and they've continued to do that. you had the running game with him with a really great quarterback prospect in 11 and a good solid receivers. Pretty tough to stop. Tough to stop at any level.
And you have said it all evening that we've had seen the great players play great in these big games.
We really have. It's just been terrific. You know, you hope for that, but you don't always get it. It just doesn't always work out. And the two games that we've done today, I mean, it's brought out the cream in everyone.
Laysbrook carries to the 11-yard line, pick up a 5 after that previous gain of 18. We approach the midway point of the fourth quarter. Rochester looking to put the hammer down now. Laysbrook looking for touchdown number 4. Won't come on that play. Only gets a yard to the 10. Good job by Michael Peters. Peters, what a great story for Peters. Peters did not play last year. His dad passed away a couple of weeks before the season started in 2009. Peters actually, unfortunately, the last person to talk to his father and the first person to find him. He decided not to play, but the coaching staff and the players all accepted him on the team. He was invited to all the team meetings. Any team functions, he was part of it. He just chose not to play on the field, and yet here he is playing in a state title game this evening. Laysbrook can't shake free. Once again, it was Peters that turned him in. Hoogerwerf with the final tackle. A couple yards for a first down.
Remember Rock Island fighting to the end here. Alleman is fighting to the end. They're scratching. You know, it's all a downhill battle for them right now, but they're fighting. Be nice for them to get the stop here on fourth down.
What a big night for Colton Laysbrook. 7.8 yards a carry, 197 yards. He's also caught a touchdown pass, 75 yards receiving. To the end zone. Too much.
Just a little too much.
Laysbrook will probably go pick up that ball. He's done everything else tonight. He'll chase it down there deep in the end zone. Blunt was looking to his senior running back here. Laysbrook tonight, you can add 89 yards and receptions onto the 97 on the ground. What a way for a senior to go out.
That's a full day's work today.
His coach, Derek Leonard, said he may be the most underrated player he's ever had. I don't know that you can say that too much longer.
Yeah, I don't know if we underrate him after tonight. And it doesn't surprise me because I've liked him in all the tapes I've seen. And to me, it was just a matter of getting him featured, getting him the ball. And it all started with that screen. All started with that screen. Because any time that he's in space, he's got you. They also, Coach Leonard does a great job with that trap pull game, both the guard and the center off that one back offense. They get you all spread out, they get the line spread, and then they run that trap pull series. And with a kid like Laysbrook, you could take it in that hole and go. Pretty tough to defend.
Tim Boland has thrown 11 passes tonight. That's a little bit more than he generally throws. He's had to do it tonight. Of course, several of those passes came at the end of the first half when Alleman was actually driving for a chance to possibly take the lead going into halftime.
You really thought that maybe they had some daylight there, but you know, at the end of the day, Rochester's a class team.
Boland over the middle, just off the hands of Justin Quintana. Boy, if that one is about 3 inches shorter, Quintana may have something there.
Quintana.
It's been an offense for Alleman in the past. I mean, the past years has strictly been run. This year, Boland gave him a little bit extra dimension, able to throw the ball a little bit.
And what they want to do is they want to throw. When you're a triple option team, you want to throw as a complementary part of your offense. When you're forced to throw this much, it's just not who you are. Your linemen aren't in a protection mode. Your receivers aren't in that kind of mode. It's a complementary pass offense. Boland's done a fine job. He's really done a fine job. But it's just not what your team is.
Well, he takes a big hit. He goes down as that pass falls incomplete.
See, but where you start to break down, too, particularly against a defensive line like Rochester, is your team's just not used to pass protecting play after play after play. I remember when I coached in college, when you got a when you got an option team and you got ahead of them, you had them.
Aaron Odell put the pressure on that time, 6'3", 305 pounder.
Fourth down, Captain
Ewald. Ewald has been a busy man tonight. This will be his ninth punt of the evening. He's averaged 27 and a half yards his previous eight. Rochester will get it as we've played on this south end of the field for most of this fourth quarter. 4 minutes and 31 seconds between the Rockets and the state championship in Class 4A. That's the one they're playing for right there. Well, that trophy presentation coming up following tonight's game. They've already given away three of the first place trophies. Blaisbrook tackled from behind by Ryan O'Keefe. Ryan O'Keefe, his uncle David, works for Deere & Company in China. And so here's the beauty of ESPN3.com. We're about 12 hours difference from China, but David O'Keefe's, or O'Keefe's uncle, David, he may be watching right now on ESPN3.com. Well, your nephew just got a tackle.
The one thing I do like about Rochester is their ability to use some I formation. Most teams that are shotgun spread, shotgun offset, don't have a changeup. And I like the idea that they can run the I formation. You know, they still get their pulls with it, but it gives you an alternative offense in your system, particularly in bad weather. You know, if you have to eat a little bit of clock, I think that's impressive that they can change gears a little bit.
It was quite some time ago we showed you the yardage differential between Rochester and Alleman. That's when Alleman had 124 yards. Right now they're at 117. That's what the defense has done for Rochester. And of course, you play with the lead, you can really get after it. But this is a Rochester defense that has done this all season long.
Yeah, they've actually done a terrific job on the option tonight. This is a good option team, Alleman. They have hurt people. They've gotten big plays on the perimeter, and Alleman has done Rochester's done a great job all night shopping the inside, and then their outside perimeter people have done a great job of tackling on the outside, and they basically bottled them up. In the second half, it's really been total domination by Rochester right from the first play on. So, you know, kudos to them. They did a great job of adjusting, getting their feet under them in the second half.
Rockets ranked number one all season long in Class 4A. Alleman just kept climbing the polls. They finished number two after the regular season had completed. They making their fourth appearance in the state finals. And each time they got to the championship game, it was a close loss. All three previous losses have been by less than 8 points. They fell in 1986 to Tinley Park, finished second to Belleville-Altoff in 1990. And then the last time Alleman was here was in 2005. They lost 28-21. To Sacred Heart Griffin, and the head coach for Sacred Heart was Ken Leonard, the father of Rochester's Derek Leonard. A third and five, Wes Lunt. To Glazebrook, 5 yards and more. Up over 200 yards tonight on the ground for Colton Glazebrook. Rochester keeps it going. With 3:04 to play. As Glazebrook's 29th carry of the night. You get the feeling the Rockets like to punch one more in here for good measure. A little jet sweep action here. And that's Michael Gunter to the 11-yard line.
Yeah, the hardest thing they might have is turning the throttle down. I think that might be the hardest thing they have to do.
Gunter, his first rushing attempt. He only becomes a third ball carrier of the night. for Rochester. Wes Lutz carried it five times. He's lost yardage. Of course, some of those on sacks. Colton Glazebrook, 29 carries, 212 yards on the ground, another 89 in the air. That's 300 yards of offense for Glazebrook.
How about that in the state championship game? 300 yards.
What a way to go out. Now Lunt letting that play clock wind down. Lunt won't get any more. Look at that Alleman defense. They're still in there sticking.
They are fighting. They're fighting to the end.
That's the type of players this team has been for Dave DeJager's team. He is so proud of them. He is such a tight-knit unit. They play so hard.
There's no doubt. And they were impressive, and they gave it their best shot. They really did. It's a skill set here. This Rochester team is skilled, really so impressive. It's almost mind-boggling to me how skilled they are.
It's been a fun team to watch. Hope all the folks who have been with us all evening on the IHSA TV network and ESPN3.com have enjoyed it as well. Oh, get smoked that time.
Well, we've seen some great football in eight quarters, and the thing about it is we've seen a lot of different kinds of football. That's, I think, the great thing about high school football. You can see a phone booth offense, and in the next play, we come out here and we see a ton of passes. We see 36 passes. So, you know, that's just the difference, the contrast in two games, and yet it's all fun. It's all good.
Nick Kavanaugh got that hit on, and maybe the last real hit. It'll be the last hit of Kavanaugh's career. And there'll have to be one more snap of this ball. We'll take the delay of game penalty here. Or the timeout. They choose to take the timeout with 29 seconds left. That will give the Rochester fans a chance to do a little celebrating. You already have the headlines out. Rockets rule. Indeed they have here tonight in your 4A title game.
Yeah, they really have. It's been impressive. Definitely dominated that second half and definitely deserved this title.
It's one thing when you're favored at the beginning of the season. It's another thing when you feel like you really have to overcome a bad ending last year. They were inches away from getting to the state title game last year. And a comeback is very, very special.
Well, this is as fine of operation as you're going to see. I mean, from top to bottom, from Coach Leonard through his coaching staff. I mean, this is impressive on both sides of the ball. This is a well-coached team on all aspects of the game. It is not a simple team. This is a team that has a lot of complexities. This is, like I said, even, you know, for a guy like myself who's been in it 41 years, very impressive.
And this ball is oh my goodness. About for all the execution of this offense. Oh gosh, Derek Leonard, yeah, he's all smiles. And that's good to see too. I mean,
he should be, really. He realized that first half that he had to get things cranked up and they did it. They went out and did it.
Alleman to run a couple of plays here, depending on how they elect to play this. Rochester scrambling to get some people in the game. Mendoza the carry. And with that, the clock will continue to wind. The Rochester players come onto the field. Dave DeJager tells his team, come on over, and you look at Derek Leonard. There's no holding back right there for the six-year head coach. You know, and he said it, you know what? He said, we're pretty stinking good. Yeah, yes, you are, coach.
And like you said earlier, it just stepped right out of that pink shadow. Stepped right out, right into the deserved limelight.
Rochester, a 24-7 winner tonight over Alleman. Pioneers came in here. We expected a good game. We got a good game. The Pioneers knew they would be underdogs in this game. It was 7-7 until John Perry kicked a 25-yard field goal in the second quarter to give it a 10-7 lead for Rochester. And from then on, two touchdowns early in the third quarter, and that was it. Derek Leonard looking for anybody and everybody to shake hands and give hugs to. He's just won a state championship. Back with more from this Memorial Stadium right after this. It is a good time in Champaign if you're a Rochester fan tonight. And the players even heading up into the stands. Look like Dan Camp was up there. The big Rochester flag flowing, and it's a 24-7 win, capping off a 14-0 season for Rochester. Last year they lost just one game. And they're going to pick up a big trophy in just a second. What a happy bunch of guys.
It's really interesting to watch them. They, you know, as I said, that is not a simple offense. That's a complex offense. Matter of fact, when I watch offenses like that, I'm glad I'm in the booth and not as a defensive coordinator. Very difficult. They actually have a nice mix with Glazebrook running the football. They constantly have those trap games, which again take a little bit away from your pass rush. And then a masterful job with the screen game tonight. You know, screens can be a tremendous weapon, whether they're the outside screens. And yeah, you could make the case that screen broke the game open tonight. The first one to start the second half to Glazebrook. They got it out to him, got him in space. He did the rest. What a great night for him. 300 yards. There's guys that can't do that against the air. That's 300 yards in a state championship game. That's just incredible.
You know, and for Rock Island Alleman, okay, they came in here against a team that was averaging 40-some points a game. You had said as a defensive coordinator you would hate to prepare against the spread. Rock Island Alleman, they do not even get to see the spread.
No, and honestly, they had the formula. They really did. They came out. They played a fine first half. You know, the game was close. They were eating clock. They were trying to shorten the game. But, you know, at the end of the game, as Rochester started to create more space with their players, get them out in open spaces, the skill set took over. And then, you know, once they put the pedal to the metal, they didn't take it off.
You talk about the 1-2 combination. We just saw Wes Luntz, number 213 yards in the air. Of course, 89 of those went to Glazebrook, throwing another 208 yards on the ground for Glazebrook. That's a 1-2 combination, of which only one of them is coming back next year. But he's a good one. There's a lot of folks that all of a sudden said, oh, Wes Luntz, the quarterback from Rochester. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, if there's a guy that you want to build around in this state next year, it's Wes. I mean, I would love to build around him because, as I said before, there's not a throw in the arsenal he can't make, and he's so athletic, and he does it easy, very smart, directs traffic out there. Yeah, your future's bright with that guy.
Rock Island Alleman ends their season at 13-1. They ran through the Western Big Six Conference, won this conference title as the smallest school in that conference. They motored through the playoffs. They got themselves here to this championship game. They wondered whether the offense was going to be able to produce enough to get themselves enough points to overcome this high-powered offense for Rochester. Not to be, but Dave DeJager, the head coach we mentioned earlier, so very proud of his team.
And rightly he should be. I mean, they came in, they fought it out. You know, they had a formula, they tried to get it. But when you get behind with a triple option type offense, you're just out of whack. You're asking your offensive line to do things that they're not adept at doing. And, you know, it was just a situation tonight, really, of the better team prevailing. You know, they prevailed over the 60-minute battle for a half. It was close. But the second half, they put her in overdrive.
You know, you just got a quick glimpse there at Tim Boland, number 5. He's about ready to get his medal, and somebody must have said something, or he looked at somebody and he had a smile on his face. And that truly is what it's all about, too.
Yeah, Alleman has nothing to be, nothing to be ashamed of. They came in tonight, they gave it their very best shot, and you walk away from it and you realize that, hey, you know, we had a heck of a year. We lost to a great football team.
Second place medal is being draped across the heads. There's Ryan Sheely. He had a couple of big hits, a couple of catches tonight. Dave DeJager pick up another second place ribbon back in 2005. That wasn't that long ago they were right here. But how about what the Pioneers did? After their last two seasons, they finished 5-4. They finished out of the playoffs. Didn't even make the playoffs, so they don't get all those extra weeks of practice. And now here they come, and they take it up to the very last night.
Yeah, I think that's a tremendous accomplishment. You know, kind of just the opposite of our first game tonight. You know, teams that everyone had that expectation. You know, these guys just scratch and clawed. And went from a marginal football team to a state caliber team that's playing for all the marbles here in the last night. So again, they have nothing to be ashamed of. You know, it's a great traditional program there. And again, just lost to a fast-breaking, impressive team in Rochester.
Well, you know, that's an interesting comment, the fast break, and that's what they ran all night. And even if they didn't run that play every 10 seconds, they were ready to go and ready to put that pressure on the defense. And I just can't say enough about how Alleman was able to prepare as effectively as they did in such a short amount of time.
No, they really did. I don't think you can also minimize the defense of Rochester. I thought the Rochester defense was really impressive. You know, I study the triple option. I think the triple option is an offense that creates a lot of issues to a defense, no matter how good your personnel, forces you to play assignment football, forces you to make a lot of one-on-one tackles, and that's, I thought, Rochester was impressive. You know, they shut down the inside running game with those big guys, but they got people to the perimeter, and I thought their secondary was just exceptional in tackling tonight. And if you don't do that against triple option, you got problems. So this was a complete win. Basically, they won every phase of the game at the end of the day. And, you know, that's what champions do. That's what champions are made of. And in this case, this is clearly the champion of this division.
Derek Leonard, you've seen him jumping around the sidelines. You see the smile on your face. We saw Jim Unruh in 3A the same way. A lot of times you see a lot of coaches are very stoic after winning it, like, yes, I'm glad it's over. We should have done it. And then you see the elation on that side. And Derek Leonard has done that. And now the Leonard family can celebrate with son Derek. He gets himself the state title. Congratulations
to
him.
I love that emotion because that's what this game is all about. I've never been stoic. I don't even know what that means. And you know, I love it on both guys, both coaches at the end are choked with emotion. And the time, people don't realize the time and that goes in and the pressure and the angst that goes into coaching, and particularly when you're the favorite in some ways, and when you're supposed to be from the beginning of the year and you live with that burden. That's a very difficult situation. It's tough, and so that when you do achieve it, it's terrific.
So the Rochester Rockets down off the podium, and now everybody gets to share in that first place championship trophy. 24-7 winners tonight over Rock Island Alleman. Back with more from Memorial Stadium after this, your IHSA football.
We are here with your 4A state champion head coach Derek Leonard of the Rochester Rockets. Coach, a season of firsts for you guys. First year in a bigger, more competitive conference that ended with your first conference championship there in the CSA. Now you complete your first undefeated season with your first state championship. How's it feel?
It's awesome, man. I gotta give all praise to the Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, he's put me there, put my team there. Like you said, we went to a bigger conference. Not many people think we can do it. And it's been the perfect year. I mean, we beat everyone to put in front of us. I'm just so proud of these kids, the coaches, and the community.
And you were very patient tonight. You said at halftime, the first half was one of the worst halves you played all year. You guys stayed with your game, and you ended up pulling away in this one tonight.
We did. And overall, it wasn't a great game. But you know what? That's these kids. They fought hard. They got after it. And, you know, even though they knew they weren't playing great, they still, defense came and really played well. And I thought we played a great game overall.
Coach, thanks a lot. Congratulations. Go celebrate. Derek Leonard, the Rochester Rockets, your Class 4A state champs.
Tradition here, following the championship games, you get your team photo taken, whether you be a winning team or a losing team. Dave Bernhardt along with Rick Venturi. And Rick, we're going to see four more games tomorrow. But we're going to see some teams that Rochester certainly could play for regardless of class.
I don't think there's any question. I mean, you know, I I've been in this business at all levels for 41 years, and that's a very impressive team. I mean, to take a high school team and be as versatile on both sides of the ball is something to behold.
This was the big play of the second half, that quick screen. This was the first play coming out of halftime to Colton Glazebrook. Took this one for about 62 yards. Glazebrook wanted to get it right there with the score. Instead, he says, I'll wait a couple plays later. He goes in for a touchdown. That stretched a 10-7 lead to 17-7. Tim Boland trying to ride his team back. Minnesota City is ridden down by that big defensive front for Rochester. And here are your final numbers. Look at that domination in the yardage, 414 to 119. Rochester averaging 5.6 yards per play, and they end up winning it 24-7. We'll be back and wrap things up from Memorial Stadium at 4A Championship in the books. And those guys right there, your state champs from Rochester. Dave Fernhardt and Rick Venturi back here with you at Memorial Stadium, starting to clean out here following the 4A Championship game. And Rick, pleasure working with you here in these 3A and 4A games. Had a couple of good ones, saw some great games, saw some great players.
Oh, it's been my honor, honestly, to be associated. I think we saw two things tonight. We saw a dominating champion in 4A, really impressive. And I think we saw one of the great football games of the year, football games of many year, that did live up to the billing and was just terrific. It was sad that somebody actually had to lose that one.
We've had four games played here today. It got started at 10 o'clock this morning, the 1A championship game won by Lena Winslow. You see the scores right there, 47-14, 2A game. It was Newman Central Catholic from Sterling knocking off Moroa Forsyth, 48-7. Then, as Rick said, the 3A game, what a classic that was. 22-20 win. It went down to the last second with Illini West over Stillman Valley. And then Class 4A, Rochester knocking off Alleman, 24-7. And the best thing about it is we get to do it all over again tomorrow. Looking forward to it, Rick.
Yes, sir. Let's get them, line it up and go.
Your 5A game will come at you at 10 a.m. It'll be Lee Hall and Rick Venturi, along with the 6A game. Then Jack McInerney will join me for 7A and 8A. I'd like to thank Rick for joining me and for our entire production crew. I'm Dave Fernhardt saying so long from Memorial Stadium in Champaign, Illinois. The preceding has been an exclusive presentation of the Illinois High School Association.